Yo, yo, NFT Paris, you know what I'm gonna ask? One more time, can we clap it up one more time for an incredible panel, Look.
Yeah.
Can I be honest with you all? Can I be honest really quick? I've had an opportunity to introduce some incredible people onto this stage, other stages, other conferences. I don't think any are as special as this next name. So I'm gonna ask a favor, I promise. It'll be the only favor I ask for the rest of this conference, for the rest of the week. When I introduce this next name, I need to hear the loudest clap, the loudest excitement I've heard from y'all all night. And do not make me ask twice. So really quickly and without further ado, can we clap it up and welcome to the stage, Yat Siu. Thank y'all, thank y'all, thank y'all.
Thank you. All right, thank you. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here again in Paris. Today I want to talk to you about unlocking better capitalism. I have very little time before the esteemed panel talks about Web3 gaming. Why is Web3 important and how can it change capitalism? I think it's a bigger purpose here. First of all, we are in a world right now where capitalism is broadly broken to most people. The Gini coefficient is the worst that it's ever been all over the world. This is just the US, but you can basically see this is true for almost every Western country in the world. The rich get richer, the poor obviously get poorer and become poorer. And it's gotten to a point where most of the narrative, which includes politics, has been around distancing from capitalism. It's become fashionable to talk about Marxism and socialism, right? The things that have got us into so much trouble 100 years ago, we are now talking about it as some kind of solution again. And books are coming out talking about techno-feudalism, about capitalism as a myth, about the inequality trap, and it's true. The current form of capitalism does have problems, but I think Web3 can fix it. And I think the problem, of course, is that for young people, they're basically veering, especially in places like the US, the kind of place that you would never have imagined to sort of actually even embrace socialism as a way, that they're now basically tending towards saying that that might be better. And the reason why is that because they've been excluded from the capitalist opportunities because of the way that it's set up right now. Why is that? Well, let's first talk about where most of the value and growth has happened, which has been in the early days of the internet, between Web 1 and Web 2. Data, which is the most valuable resource, actually is now being farmed by these platforms. And these companies now are worth trillions of dollars today. 10 years ago, the biggest market cap of a company was maybe $500 billion. And all the value is accruing to these companies that take our data, harness the information, get the network effects, and then basically sell it back to us in the form of advertising. All the value is going to them. They farm us for our resources. And actually what happens today is that we're in a world where we're existing in these data empires. You have 1 million followers on Instagram, they're not your followers, they can take it away. You're actually working for these networks, they're not yours. You know, when Elon Musk acquired Twitter and renamed it X, the person who used to own the @X handle, he lost it. It's akin to someone basically taking the property that you own. And that's the problem we have today. We actually don't own anything in the digital world, and actually where all the growth opportunities have come out. And even when you think about AI, the great opportunities that AI have brought about, who are the investors or the people who got to benefit from the growth of AI? We get to use the tools, that's nice, but actually nobody, no regular person had an opportunity to invest in the opportunity of AI or to participate in the capital growth and the capitalist opportunity of AI except the exclusive 1%. And this, we think, is one of the reasons why places like the US actually don't like crypto. And particularly, we see this in gaming. And part of it is, you know, because gaming is probably one of the few areas in the digital world where there is a meritocratic approach, meaning you can be someone, have social status, have social reputation, without actually having to spend money. And that's why when we introduce things like NFTs to gamers, their first reaction, even though it's better for them, is, oh my goodness, are you introducing all the type of things that are not working for me in real life into the actual digital world? Does it mean that I have to buy a Bored Ape or a Land and Sandbox to be able to actually participate in this sort of form of entertainment when, you know, it's not, it seems unfair? And that's why I think gamers in the US in particular don't like NFTs, because from their perspective, it's actually sort of introducing a form of digital capitalism, even though they don't really feel that. And you can see how they react to it. They don't talk about it in a sort of logical sort of way. It's very emotional. It's very sort of, you know, it's something that really sort of hurts them. In contrast, Asia has embracing NFTs and crypto and Web3 for the most part. It's even, you know, we even have in Asia the launch of a GameFi index, which is now quoted on Bloomberg, where you're able to basically have the beginnings probably of a future GameFi ETF. Not happening right now, but it's already happening where people can sort of trade crypto. NFT gaming is booming in Asia in particular, blockchain games. And of course, places like Hong Kong have more open regulations. And this is in large part because in Asia, people are embracing capitalism and they look at it as a positive thing because in places like Asia, if you look at China, South Korea, those countries, over the last 30, 40 years, they actually experienced a world where there was no property rights, where there was no capitalism. And it was actually capitalism, property rights that gave them opportunity. So even if there was inequity, they understood that opportunity. They understand why it's better, broadly speaking, which is also, I think, one of the reasons why this certainly, next couple of years, crypto is going to grow in particular in Asia. So why is Web3 important? Well, I think Web3 can actually restore our hope in capitalism and the opportunity in this because it distributes capital value more fairly across the space. You know this already, we're in a Web3 conference, but it's worth mentioning again that in the traditional Web2 shareholder capitalist way, most of the value goes to investors and builders in the space. But actually in Web3, you get, you know, the entire community gets to benefit. It's people who are users, creators, and of course, the builders and investors all get to participate. Maybe not exactly equally, but there's a way in which we could all partake, whether this is in airdrops or whether this is in, you know, basically sort of farming or whether this is actually in investing. It doesn't really matter. Everyone has a much more equal opportunity to participate. And it actually means that capitalism is shared more broadly and more fairly across the ecosystem. And this comes from the fact that we actually have the ability to own our assets. The foundation of capitalism starts with property rights. And the property rights that we take for granted almost in the physical world, like owning your house, owning your car, owning a piece of painting, or owning some kind of assets, is something that is actually new in the digital world, because if you think about it, you don't own anything in the digital world until Web3. So the same effects that we're going to see happening in the physical area of property rights, we'll see happening in the digital area. And this comes basically through this form of stakeholder capitalism, where you now have alignment through ownership. In the same way that if you all are owners in real estate in your neighborhood, you have an alignment in the common purpose of that land or that city, you have the same happening with NFT communities, with gaming communities, because you're not actually just a gamer in that sense, a participant. You're an owner in the network. And if you do well in the network, if the network grows, then you actually get to partake in the growth of that network as well. And the other thing is that whether it's public blockchains or metaverses or Web3 gaming, they're actually viewed, can be viewed very much like economies. And blockchain is not just a technology. It's actually more of a social, economic, human sort of type of system that really embeds capitalism at its core. Because if you think about how is blockchain defended, the consensus mechanism of blockchain, it's a capitalist mechanism. You can't force your way into controlling it unless you have capital. And so, to my closing statements, in the physical world, every country that has property rights has capitalism, has higher GDPs, has higher incomes. Whether this is the US, whether this is UK, whether this is France, every place that has a respect for property rights has an ability to have this capital formation. Because I own a real estate, I can get a mortgage, I can get composability of different things I can do on top of my physical assets. And now this is the same that will happen in the digital world with NFTs and tokens. The countries that have low property rights, North Korea, or name your country that doesn't have property rights, actually those are the kind of places that have very low GDPs and are amongst the poorest in the world. And that is where we are today in Web 2. Why are we, as end users, worth only 1 or 2 or 3 cents per user? It doesn't make any sense. That's because actually, in that version of Web 2, those advertising that basically we're supposedly worth in Facebook or Google is because we are in a low property rights paradigm. It's not an actual fair market. It's an algorithm that determines who gets to see what. I mean, why is it okay that when we spend money in advertising on, say, Facebook or Google, we have a single-digit conversion percentage rate, and we're supposed to think that's good? We don't even know. It's not a fair market in Web 2. And Web 3, again, because it's on-chain, it's transparent, we have a fair market, we have actually a capitalist framework. So I want to close this quickly. You're moving on to a Web 3 gaming panel soon anyway. Gaming is a $100 billion sort of virtual goods market right now in a $200 billion space. And you know, the natural thinking has always been, well, if you actually give gamers property rights, this $100 billion should be worth trillions. And that is a correct assessment. But it's been difficult to get Web2 gamers into Web3 because we have this issue here, which is that the person who's in Web3 is not necessarily the person who plays games, right? And so this is a little larger than it is today. This pie will grow, but the people who are both Web3 and gamers tends to actually be a fairly small number. And how do we actually bring people, in this example, from Web2 games into Web3 properly? And we think it has a lot to do with teaching them about capitalism. No Web3 user is truly a Web3 user unless they understand money, unless they have an appreciation of investment, unless they appreciate, basically, financial literacy, have some form of financial literacy. Of your friends who are not in Web3, how many of them actually have a stock portfolio? How many of them actually think about investing? How many even have a framework around that? And so I think the big opportunity in Web3, and especially Web3 gaming, is that we can onboard people by giving them financial literacy through the process, understanding value. And actually, I think the next hundreds of millions of people that are onboarded through Web3 gaming are also going to be onboarded to have financial literacy, which then makes them more financially included, which grows the space as a whole. And imagine what happens if most of the world actually know a little bit about money. And we've seen these cases already in cases like the Philippines with Axie Infinity, for instance, or in places like, you know, what Sandbox has developed, you know, by bringing people in who are now more financially literate because of Web3, because they can have a wallet. And I guess at the end of the day, if we can teach our children algebra and math in general, then we can certainly teach them compound interest and other things that matter to the financial world. So thank you so much.